The reason why it's long is because we want to hear from you also. So we're going to be giving you our stories, but we want to hear your stories. So we ask all of you to please participate, because that's how we really learn from one another. And the other note I wanted to say is I shared with people as you were walking in, it's very difficult for me to stay seated. So if I start to pop up, all of you need to say, what is it? Sit down. That's right. Thank you. Elizabeth?
I've asked Melissa to bring in some rope. I think we're just going to tie her to the chair. It might be more effective. Before we get started, we want to get a sense of who's in the room. And so, by a show of hands, do we have anyone here from secondary education? Are we all higher education? A community-based organization? Okay, so how many of you are community-based organizations? Excellent. How many of you are working on university campuses? And those of you who are from other, okay, very good. All right, also from those of you who are on campuses, how many of you are at public universities? Private? How many are from for-profit institutions? Very good. And looking at the size of your student body, how many of you are on campuses that have less than 1,000? Less than 5,000? Less than 15,000? 15,000 or more? Wow. Nice. Very good. And I'm just curious always about your positions or your roles. That way we can make sure that what we're saying is applicable. How many of you do not work in financial aid? Okay, so those of you who are raising your hands, what offices are you representing?
Bursar.
Bursar, okay. Academic advising, great.
Welcome.
Yes, sir. Default management. Great. And I saw some hands back there.
Counseling.
Very good.
Nice.
Student services. Very excellent. Nice. Good, then we have a lot to share from each other. And hopefully you'll learn something from us. Those of you who are in financial aid, tell me what your roles are. Give me an idea of what you're doing.
Can we take the mics around to some people? Thank you. Who wants to share from financial aid?
Over here.
Okay.
Financial aid advisor.
Okay.
Loan coordinators.
Loan coordinators.
Executive director with not only financial aid, but also enrollment management.
Excellent.
Nice. I'm also an executive director, financial aid scholarships, and just recently undergraduate recruitment.
Very good.
Excellent. I'm an assistant director, and I'm from Ohio. I'm from a private school in Ohio. So
okay. Excellent.
Can we go back over here for a moment? Will you take the mic back for a second?
Sure. To that?
No, the nice lady in the orange shirt.
Oh.
Yeah. Can you tell us again what your role is? Because it was interesting, that the combination that you just said.
It's financial aid office, scholarship office, and undergraduate recruitment.
Okay.
Not
so,
admissions office, just recruitment.
Okay, so tell us what the difference is on your campus.
Well, I think the reason that they paired undergraduate recruitment with us is because financial aid is such an important piece.
Absolutely.
And it's a way to get all of the recruitment staff really well-trained in issues of, you know, the financing of an education, and then hopefully from there moving to financial literacy also, so that they can assist with those efforts.
That's a great model. Does anyone else have that type of model on your campus? Thank you.
Anyone else want to share what your role is at your particular campus, whether it's in financial aid or not?
I work in enrollment services and financial aid, so we do both.
Excellent. Nice. Okay, before we get started, you all have paper and pen in front of you. We're going to take a little quiz. This is the faculty member coming out, right? You don't have to turn it in, though. It's a little self-assessment just to kind of ask you a very short quiz. Two questions. Number one is thinking about the type of institution you're from. We're talking about degree completion. So what do you think the national average is of six-year degree completion in your institution type?
And when we say type, we mean public or private?
That's right. Four-year, two-year. Okay. What do you think is the degree completion rate at your institution type? And Elizabeth is going to be sharing the actual answers with you. And again, you don't have to turn them in. Because I'm looking at some of your faces, and I'm thinking, you know. So that's great.
Great.
And then the second question, right, and again, you don't have to share this. We are going to ask you if you want to share it later, is what is the degree completion rate on your campus?
Okay. That said, we're going to get started. What we want to do right now is kind of take a step back and look at the national picture on what we see happening in enrollments across the country. And we find that, not surprisingly, with all the focus on getting more access and more students into our campuses, that is exactly what is happening. We see that there has been incredible increase. When you compare 20 years ago from 1989 to 99, and then from 99 to 2009, you see a significant difference in the percentage of students that were enrolling in college. We went from an increase of 9% to an increase of 38%. And not only was there that dramatic increase, but we saw both increases in the number or the percentage of students who were going full-time as well as part-time, males, females. And looking at the number of 18 to 24-year-olds, it's not surprising to learn that nationally we had also a large increase in that particular population. But even more so than the 14% increase that we saw in those individuals who were 18 to 24 years old, we saw a 36% increase in their enrollment in college. And so we look back on some of the initiatives and think, wow, we have been successful in getting our students into campus, but now we see that there's this shift. You know, now that we're getting them there, what are we doing once they arrive? For Title IV institutions, we look at the number of students that they were enrolling for the fall of 2010, 19 million students, and we see the breakdown between our four-year, our two-year campuses. We know that there's been a large push to get more students into our community colleges. How many of you are coming from community colleges? Raise your hands. Okay, just two of you. We know that you all have been flooded with your enrollments, and so we look at that increase and we ask, why are the students going there? What is it that they're seeking? Are they seeking to transfer to four-year campuses with the hopes of obtaining their bachelor's degree, and are they doing so? We're going to get into some of those discussions as we proceed. When we look at the students, the proportion, I find this interesting. When I was actually on a campus at St. Edward's University, I think we had about 98% of our students that would choose to stay in Texas. And so there's been a lot of work from campuses coming Ohio to recruit our students and to get them out of the state. You're here learning. Oh, and we do, and we welcome you to come, but we see that you're only, I think, you know, it's more than doubled, but what, 92%, almost 93% are still staying here in Texas. And so we have quite a bit of responsibility as the educational community to make sure that we are doing the best we can to serve these students and to enable them to be successful in reaching their goal. I thought it was interesting that 36%, basically 37% choose to stay in Vermont that are from Vermont. It's so beautiful, but I don't think I want to stay there either.
Are any of you from Vermont? Okay, how many of you are from Texas? Excellent. Do you know why our students want to stay? Hey. What do you think the reason is, the research says why they want to stay in Texas? Okay.
The economy.
Okay.
Family.
Absolutely, and that's what the research says. It's that most of our students culturally want to be near their families.
Oh, she said she was forced to stay. So, okay, either the students want to be near their families or their families demand that they will be near them.
Yes,
and
right.
So how about that? Okay. We see that the one-year retention rates, and these are national figures, for those students who are entering higher education who are full-time was 72% as compared to 44% for those students who are part-time. And I think this would bear out on our campuses. Are you seeing that your students who are enrolled full-time are more successful in persisting than those who are enrolled part-time? Okay. So we see here that the graduation rate, or the six-year completion rate, for those seeking a bachelor's degree or equivalent was 58%. How many of you all have that figure? Sandy.
Okay. How many had it?
I had 60.
Excellent. 60? Wonderful. Okay. And then you want to look at the different types of institutions?
Yeah.
Okay.
One of the things that we saw, and I think that I think that I'm giving my cameraman some difficulty there. Am I not? Okay. Because I see them doing all these things around me. And looking at the completion rate, the four-year completion rate, it's not something that we talk about very often. And actually, there's, I think, our next slide that looks at what would be a completion rate. That's 200% of the average program length. But we see that at our private nonprofit institutions, they remain the most successful in graduating our students in 4 years. 52% as compared to 31% who are graduating from public institutions. For our for-profit institutions, the total is 20%, and you have some that are doing an incredibly good job and others not so good. But when you look at the entire sector, we see that it's overall 20%.
Okay. So now we want to kind of look at your answers, because you had two questions there. The first question, of course, was the national average, and I said, I think three people said that they had close to at 60%. Okay. How many of you had a higher number? Raise your hand. About three of you. And how many of you had a lower number? Raise your hand. Okay.
Excellent. Some of you who had lower numbers, what numbers did you think? 50%? Not much
okay.
lower.
All right.
About 40.
40%? Okay. Excellent. Okay. Right. And those that had higher, what type of institution are you from?
Private.
Okay. Excellent. All right. And before we move on, I wanted to ask you also, did anyone want to share what your completion rates were on your campus? Go ahead.
It's about 86%.
We're
talking about 6 years, right?
Okay, excellent.
Okay, it's not 4 years.
No, we're talking 6 years. That's great. What type of institution are you from?
A 4-year public institution.
Okay. 4-year public.
Very good. Excellent.
How many students?
About 50,000.
50,000.
Okay, nice.
Very good.
Very good. Anyone else want to share? Okay.
Now, in looking at those completion rates and understanding the completion rates and the type of institution, then the question becomes, where are our students enrolling? So we see that 91% of our students are enrolling at public institutions. And if you recall, they had a 31% four-year completion rate. And so 94% are at nonprofit institutions, so that's your public and your private, and then we have 29% that are enrolling in our for-profit institutions. That number continues to increase. We see that in looking at the 100 versus 200% of normal program length, when you consider our community colleges, they're at 23%, and then they move to about 37%. And those who are in less than 2-year institutions, many of those are for-profit or in programs that do not require the full 2 years. For example, certificate-seeking programs or programs where students are able to obtain certificates, then we see that the percentage is about 45 to 70%. One of the reasons why those programs tend to be higher is that they're cohort-based. And so you have students who will enroll, and they're told, if you come on this day, this time every week, then we promise you by this amount of time, you will have obtained this certificate or this, looking at competencies really to get right back into the workforce. And so we see that those programs are able to have more success. It also begins to cause questioning concerning how we go about enrolling our students and how they progress through our campuses. Some of the for-profit institutions, we did a study, and one of my colleagues conducted a research study where we saw some of the for-profit institutions were being very successful because they eliminated choice. It was a matter of deciding what program you wanted, and then you were told exactly what to do, what to think, when to do it, how to do it, and as long as you stayed on track, then you were successful. And they had lots and lots of reward systems in place. So you might have a student come into class and they say, yay, this is your third time coming to class. And we're thinking, hello, why are you here? Why are you, acknowledging that behavior? But those very, what would seem to be insignificant rewards to us were very important for these students because of their background and the fact that they had very bad exposure to higher education. And so every little bit of push or every little bit that of encouragement, thank you, that they received was very, very instrumental in helping them complete.
I think we all like positive validation.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
You said that it also
brings better results.
Great. Right.
Would any of you like to share some forms of positive validation you do on your campus? You seem ready to go.
Hold on just a second. They're coming with the mics.
There you go.
You're about to wax poetic.
Nice.
Hello, my name is Charmy Sajikaye. I am from Southern Methodist University in Dallas, student account specialist. And I was agreeing with the positive reinforcement as far as getting the students to continue doing what they're doing. In my office, we basically, you know, try to take a head-on approach with students making payments, making sure that they sign up their parents as an authorized payer and because of FERPA regulations so that their parents can receive their invoices in order to pay their bill. If they do that and they pay their bill on time, then they avoid being charged late fees because we do not cancel registration if they do not pay their bill on time. So basically, individually, what I do, as a whole university, you know, we try to make sure we put out the information to the student and, you know, and let them know what they need to do. But as an individual, what I try to do is to encourage my students to, to make sure that they're doing the right things, you know. And when I talk to my parents, you know, they're so appreciative, and I don't make it a negative experience in saying that, you know, we can't give you the bill, you know, unless your daughter or your son does this. But I try to let them know the lighter point of it, you know.
Nice.
You know, we're trying to teach your child to be a responsible adult.
Do you have a marketing background?
I don't.
Okay, the reason I'm asking is, do y'all realize that she just took a very negative process of late fees and turned it into a positive concept? So she took something that many of us, I'm sure, on our campuses have conversations about, that late fee, mm-hmm. and she looked at it from a positive standpoint. This is what we're going to do so you don't have a late fee.
Exactly.
So that's excellent.
And you know what? And I'm not trying to toot my own horn, but
I'll toot it for you.
But you know, but seriously, and I have an advantage because I'm also an orientation speaker, so I have firsthand, you know, with undergraduates and graduate students. I deal with the law students, and because our tuition rate is so high, to me, it doesn't make sense that you have to be charged $150 to a $700 late fee when other things could be taken care of prior to.
Nice.
And you know, and in the event that these things happen, you know, we're kind of lenient at times to to waive these fees, but to educate our students and let them know, I'm so glad you did this. You know, I'm here for you. Great. In the future. I mean, the parents, they keep coming back. I mean, I remember them, but they remember me. So to me, that's a positive thing. And like you said, I do try to make the negative into a positive, yeah. Even if it's, you know, looking at it black and white, it's negative. But trust me, I just try to make light of the situation.
And that's really important. I think when we get to Sandy's part of the presentation, a lot of what I have to talk about, we're looking at, you know, effective practices and the research, what is, you know, borne out. But I think that what Sandy has to share will also show the importance of putting a human face to helping students and really connecting them and looking at ways that the campus engages and really humanizes the process. You know, we can become so automated and so, you know, we're throwing information out, but we're not really connecting, not really communicating with the individual. And we know that that's really important to helping students be successful. And so I'm sure that there are other stories that you all could share, and we look forward to you doing that. So we see that there is this shift. You know, the administration is looking at not only getting a certain number of degrees completed, of people who have degrees in hand by the year 2025, but they're looking at all the processes that we put in place to inform, to recruit, to promote our campuses. Are we being as diligent in looking at how we are putting those same things and that same focus and getting them to complete their degree? We see that we have federal initiatives, we have state initiatives, you have Lumina, you have TG, you have all these different organizations and companies that are all involving themselves in this idea, this discussion about increasing the number of Americans with degrees, but improving completion. You have funding that's being provided. Some campuses are reluctant to apply for certain grants because they know that there's an element of accountability that's being added to just about everything. That wasn't the case before, and they feel somewhat challenged to meet the new accountability measures that they're being asked to meet, not only from external sources, but also internally. And so I think that, again, as we get to Sandy, we'll see, and even looking at some of the practices that we'll talk about, we'll see ways that we can really help move that needle forward. The focus on recruiting, enrolling, all of those things doesn't really get us to the goal. We want a student to have their credentials in their hands. We want them to actually walk off the campus having been successful and accomplished all that they were hoping to.
Okay. Before we go to the next slide, we're going to talk about student success. And we talk about degree completion, and there's going to be a lot of conversation about student success. And Elizabeth is getting ready to show what research says about student success. But we're curious to hear how you define student success on your campus. So would somebody like to share with us?
Or even those of you who are at community-based organizations, how are you defining student success?
Student for success for us would definitely start with being able to pay back your student loans and doing it in a timely fashion. Avoiding delinquency is a big part for success for us.
Very nice.
For us in San Antonio with our Lumina grant, it's the attainment of some kind of postsecondary credential tied into earnings once they get into the workforce.
Anybody else?
Okay. Hold on 1 second. Here she comes. And we really want to get you on the mic. If you could raise your hand so they could start coming to you early. We're going to have you participating all throughout the presentation, and it is being recorded, and so the quicker they could see who you are and get the mic to you, the better the flow will be.
I'm from a community-based organization from Austin, and our student success, basically we want to ensure that our students are graduating from high school and enrolling in post-secondary education. And we're about to start a new initiative where we're doing college persistence as well. But currently it's graduate from high school and enroll in post-secondary.
And I think that demonstrates what we have viewed as success for quite some time. Graduating from high school, enrolling in college, whether it was a 2-year, 4-year, any form of post-secondary ed, that was considered to be successful. But we know that a number of those students actually didn't do what they intended to do originally. They were not successful. Yes, ma'am.
I'm a graduate program, 1 degree, 4-year regionally accredited program in Chinese medicine. So I'm just offering a master's degree. So we define success as graduation. Our retention rate's about 75% to graduation. And then professional licensure. And then we have an income statistic in terms of what we hope students can achieve as a percentage of their debt.
Good.
So.
Excellent. How do you track that?
It's tricky. We don't have we're a very small program. We only have 200 students enrolled. So I call them up and ask them, and I get them to respond. I have about an 80% response rate on my alumni surveys.
Fantastic.
Wow.
Okay.
That's impressive. Well, looking at this, the attainment of educational objectives, academic achievement, and the engagement in educationally purposeful activities. That's how one of the ways that we're looking at the definition of student success. And the definition will vary. There is not one set definition. Looking at the personal satisfaction that the student has had through their experience, the fact that they actually was able to accomplish what they set out to accomplish, that they achieved the competencies, the knowledge, the licensure, all those things, what they would need to be successful upon completing their program of study. Obviously, the fact that they began and they completed, that they retained, that they were persistent, but that they actually were able to accomplish, that they were actually able to get their degree. That's how we're looking at the definition of student success.
Okay. At this point, it's quiz number 2 time, so take out your pens, right? And our question is, what does the research say is the most efficient, not necessarily effective, but efficient way to increase your degree completion rate, so your persistence to graduation? Again, efficient.
All right. Who would like to share your answer? Raise your hand and they'll bring the mic to you. Okay, excellent. We'd like to hear from everybody at some point today. So if you haven't had the mic in your hand yet, pop your hand up at some point.
I don't want to share. Okay.
We want to hear from you a lot because you're great.
providing holistic support services.
Okay. All right. Okay. You're going to have to say the answer.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I would say this is one of the ways, great academic advising. Okay. And counseling to help the students navigate through their courses in the proper sequence.
Okay.
And nice. Develop a most successful strategy for completing their degree.
Okay.
Nice. We have one here and one there. And so
this one's one of my favorite questions.
I believe, to piggyback off what he said, with the different departments all collectively making sure that the students are able to graduate based on the academic advising, making sure the financial aid is together, making sure that the bills are paid. If we work together, coherently, it will assist in the student's success. I think every department needs to be on one accord and maybe some cross-training, not so much in, taking over their job, but assisting each other so that we can collectively make sure each and every individual student succeed.
Okay. And I saw a couple more hands again. Excellent. The most efficient way to improve completion.
Okay.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, in general, looking at the holistic approach, what does that actually entail with the support services? So if we're saying holistically they need to help the student, what does that mean? And I think student behavior, especially in their freshman year, and the types of skills that they adapt in high school going into their freshman year, and also their freshman year skills, study. How many hours a night do you study? What is implemented in them at the beginning, and along with financial skills? Yeah.
Okay. Excellent.
Here, but in the green, and then right in front.
Yeah, I would like to expand on that too, because I think a lot of the offices, financial aid advising, I think we all kind of depend on the student to come in. Mm-hmm. And, I have, wait for a situation to come up instead of being a little bit more proactive about seeking those students. And I think that would probably be, we could probably do a better effort of trying to go to the students instead of waiting for the students to come to us. And also expanding on your idea as far as getting them while they're freshmen and maybe having a freshman mandatory course for especially newcoming students, even transfer students, and have different offices, different representative for different offices explaining the financial aid process or the academic advising process. That way it encourages discussion among the students and help them better understand, what the different processes are to get their degree.
Great, excellent. One more.
I was just gonna piggyback a lot on what she said. I'm a community-based provider, and we've seen a number of campuses, college campuses, start this one-hour credit program that all freshmen or whatever hours, you make up a number that they're required to take that teaches them college study skills, the basics of everything they're going to need to offer. And the other thing that we're starting to see, and this is kind of coming out of some campuses that are going through their renewal process to get their
accreditation,
that the accreditation agencies are pushing this issue, or perhaps, so I know in our area, one of the community colleges has actually had to tackle this. And so what they're doing, it's really pretty ambitious, is they're tying all they're mandating all their departments system-wide to log their grades, and the grades are then triggering flags that then force the students, they don't have a choice, mm-hmm. to go for help if their grades are below a certain number. That's pretty ambitious.
Excellent.
And it all came out of accreditation. So it's sad that it took that, in my opinion, but I was excited to see it actually happen. I was like, wow.
Right. Excellent. So what you just talked about, the freshman year experience course that we see a number of campuses beginning to require their students to participate in, and then the early warning systems that are letting us know early, there's a problem here, let's do some aggressive intervention. All very good answers.
Very effective. But remember, our question was efficient. Okay, I think I have someone with a smile on her face over here. Let's see if she gets it. Okay. You're not going to like the answer, but.
Yeah, right. Okay. Well, one way to do it, I think, to be more efficient is increasing selectivity or your admission standards.
Exactly.
There you go.
That is the most efficient way to improve completion. You narrow your audience. You go for the students who have the stronger academic profiles, and you almost, you know, assuredly will increase your completion rates because these are the obvious ones that will be successful. And as disappointing as that answer might be, you would be surprised the number of campuses that think it possible to do just that. We see some campuses, not all of them because they're unable to do so, but we see some campuses seeking to enroll a stronger profile student, throwing more scholarship money because they want to improve graduation rates. And so their idea is not to work with the students that they have and to provide better services, but to get a better student that would require less investment on the institution's part and then could drive their numbers up as a result. That's not the population that we see graduating from our high school systems. And we see that even those who are graduating that appear to be in the top 10% really are not as academically prepared as maybe the top 10% graduating student would have been 15, 20 years ago. And so it's a very different preparation that we have. And so with that in mind, and understanding that we can't choose to become more selective and serve all these students that are coming into the pipeline, the question becomes, how are we going to be successful as a campus with shrinking budgets? None of us have the level of resources that we think important. How can we do better with what we have? And so out of that, we developed, and this is a mouthful, it's called a student-centric success, a student-success-centric institutional initiative. And that was really to help campuses who are just becoming acquainted with the importance of retention and graduation, or who are just now beginning to understand that soon state funding, federal funding, is all going to have an accountability measure that is tied to retention and completion specifically. We wanted to help them get out in front and begin doing some things that are different to increase their completion on their campus. As we sit here, I'm thinking that this is a very long presentation, and I want to get to more of the discussion, which I think will come from us looking at what some of the things that Sandy was able to do at the University of the Incarnate Word. So I would just share that all of these, all the content that are in the next few slides that's in your handout, I'm going to ask you to go through and to read that. But basically what this is, we developed a certificate in degree completion self-assessment guide and toolkit. This is something that we'll be publishing in late spring. And what the purpose was to go onto campuses that could not afford to have the expensive outfits that come in and, you know, do all these wonderful things and write these wonderful plans for you and tell you you do A, B, and C, then you'll get all these, you know, wonderful results. We wanted to provide a toolkit that was research-based that would enable us to go onto a campus and work with those administrators to see how to do their own self-assessment, to teach them the process of evaluation and implementation of new programs and policies, and to provide all this at no cost to them so that our campuses who are low resource, primarily our focus is on Title III and Title V institutions right now, that they would have a way of being successful at increasing completion and looking at the ways that they're spending their money that are ineffective and reallocating that money in a way that would be more advantageous to their students.
How many of you have a self-assessment plan on your campus? Anyone? Okay, that's not surprising. That's usually the answer we get when we ask that question.
And we think it very important. It's not something that is so complicated to where you have to have all these PhDs coming in on your campus telling you what the results mean, but they're very simple types of data that you can capture and ways of understanding what it's telling you, and then programs and policies that can be implemented as a result that would help the entire campus come together. We are very interested in the congruence of a campus, that everyone understands what the goal is, that everyone speaks the same way, that they're all on board and looking at the way that you're engaging your students, the way that you're moving them from one point to the next. And so this process is to help facilitate that. It was based in under looking at what students really need. And, you know, I'm not going to go through all of these things, but I think this particular slide and looking at what students need, we take for granted that they have it. We take for granted that they understand what the college experience is supposed to be, what it's like, that they understand how often they're going to have to go to the library, how much they're going to have to study, and that, you know, they really get the maturity that they're going to have to demonstrate. They just leave high school where everyone's telling them you do this, you do that, all the hand-holding, the helicopter moms, and, you know, my girlfriend said, I'm not a helicopter mom, I'm a jet, I'm landing, baby, you know, and that's me. I have an 8-year-old, and I'm landing, I have landed, you know, but we take them from there, they graduate, and then, you know, some transformation is supposed to happen the summer between completion of high school and enrolling in college, and then boom, suddenly they're these independent, mature, clear thinking adults who can do for themselves. Please.
Yeah.
We know that's just, it doesn't happen. And so I think going back and understanding who the students are that you serve, what the students look like on your campus and how you engage them, how do you help them to be successful? Those are the things that the toolkit, that the core propositions will cover. They're all listed, and so I'm going to scroll through them to show you that there are five ways that we break down these effective strategies. We're looking at the institutional commitment to student success. We're looking at college readiness and the support that the campuses are providing and the ways that they educate and get the students involved in their own self-advocacy and really helping to become stronger and more self-sufficient as we work with them. For those students who are coming in who might need some assistance academically, how are we working with them? How are we structuring our developmental classes? Is it that, you know, well, you're going to just be stuck here, you're not going to do anything that's really going to benefit you towards graduation and so you could prove to us that you've, you know, can make it out of this course? How are we discussing developmental education? How are we taking our students through it? Are we the most enlightened that we could be? Is this something that really is beneficial to our student, or maybe it's advantageous to a lazy faculty member or staff member who just doesn't want to put in extra effort? Are we really organized to benefit the student, or is this, you know, professional expediency? I really like to get off at 5, and you know, these kids are wearing me out. I don't like them anyway. I retire in 10 years, I'm staying here. Until then, although I'm filling a seat, I'll just pretend. You know, but are we really connected? Are we really engaged?
Okay, can we get a mic? Excellent.
If some of you weren't dying to grab a mic on that, I'm surprised.
As far as when you're talking about college readiness, are you talking about for the summer transition, or are you talking about in the high school? Are you talking about
all
what's available in the high school? Okay, so the type of support services that you implement before they come in to college.
Before they come in, but you know, there are actually three different legs of the stool. One is looking at the certificate and degree completion, another is a communication self-assessment, and then there's enrollment management curriculum and training. And so what we're saying is that we need to be involved in the high schools. Those of us who are on university campuses in post-secondary ed, we need to be involved in the high school because it's not just the counselor's role to educate our students and our families, but also it's ours. And so looking at the way that we can help them understand what the expectations are of post-secondary ed, not just our institutions. Some of us don't know anything except what we do on our own campuses, but understanding the role of post-secondary education and the type of preparation and looking at course selection, the way that campuses will view their transcripts, you know, especially, you know, not just that freshman through junior, but that senior year as well, seeing what they're enrolled in. I could go on. I mean, the whole presentation could be just on college readiness and preparation. It's not just the academic side of it, but it's also, it's the emotional side. It's helping them understand what it's going to feel like if you're leaving home, or what the parents can expect from their student who's now a college student with new demands, new expectations, what types of questions to ask, how to support. It's comprehensive.
And I'm going to add also, and we're going to talk about this when we get to my institution, is what we realized on our institution was the students need to be understand college readiness, but do we as a campus also understand college readiness? And do we all understand it the same? Do we all have the same understanding of what it means to be college ready? Because if you don't have that on your institution, then how do you expect your students to understand that? And just as importantly for them, the families and your institutions that are feeding into your institution. So I think the language has to be not only is a student ready, but are we ready also for the students?
And we see here that it looks at the institutional culture. You know, are you student-centered, success-centered? What is the institutional culture, and how are you demonstrating your commitment? And looking at the long-term success plan and what you have in place as a campus, you know, when you look at some of the models, whether you're looking at Tinto or if you're looking at Swale, they have on one side the cognitive, that's looking at the academic ability, all the various things that apply to the student as the academic, the scholar. And then they have non-cognitive, that's looking at social and all of those factors that play in there, how they're engaged on the campus, even things, you know, how they're addressing their financial needs or, you know, going out and participating in clubs and organizations. But then on the bottom of that triangle, you have the institution. And looking at that support structure or the way that the institution is organized and the way that policies are written, the way that they operate, that enable students to be successful, not those that prevent or the ones that are, you know, they're neither helpful nor harmful, but they've just not been given much thought. They're not really necessary either, but it's just the way that we've always done things. And so your institutional culture, how is that enabling or disabling student support? And then looking at this, we talked about this, you know, what is college readiness? And these are just very high level thoughts that have been organized. And then as you look at each one of these bullets, they're like 12 different types of activities or engaging factors that would enable a campus to be successful. And so, yes, ma'am. No.
No, wait for the mic.
Because I run an education corps, Illinois College Advising Corps, and what we do is we help the students get into college. So what we do is we try to put services ahead of the game, early awareness, college readiness, programs, and near-peer mentoring. And so that's why I ask, because when we go into these high schools, the definition is so different. The definition of what our advisor is responsible for, are they responsible for college acceptance or college enrollment? What does college enrollment mean? You know, year one to year two or all the way completion? And I just think, like you're saying, the definition, what it means to the university versus the high school, needs to be correlated and understood as far as, you know, what is our overall mission for the students, you know, long-term plan. So that's why I just asked because there are so many factors that come into it. So
my San Antonio colleague and I are smiling greatly at that statement. So thank you.
All the way in the back.
And that's why you're smiling, I know. In San Antonio, we're actually going to look at the systems and understand exactly what just described, because our K through 12 do not have the same lingo or jargon or expectations that our institutions of higher ed have. And so these systems are trying to come together, and there's a huge disconnect for our students. And so we're going to be looking at the systems themselves within the city of San Antonio, mm-hmm. and then equipping our families with the navigational skills and strategies to navigate whatever system they find themselves in.
Excellent. And I think she brought up a very important point, is the language of higher education. And the language that we use, are we consistent with that on our campuses? And are we consistent with it with our students, our families, from enrollment to graduation? And we're going to talk a little bit more about that, too, in just a little while.
I also wouldn't, I mean, working for TG, I think about our language quite a bit because most of my colleagues all have financial aid backgrounds. I do not. I helped to write financial aid policy But that was the extent of my work. I would go and have a meeting once a month and get all these figures and numbers and, okay, so we're doing well, right? All right, great. You know, that was the extent of it. But at TG, we have a lot of discussions that are taking place, and I'm sitting there trying to participate because everyone's talking about the way that it's going to impact institutional policy and all these different things, how they could possibly harm students or help students. And we speak a very different language, even in higher education. And so there are times when they're explaining something to me from a financial aid perspective, I'm that of an enrollment manager, so I'm not really getting the urgency that they're communicating or why it's such a big deal. And so not only do we need to look at language, we're then, you know, I guess between post-secondary and secondary, but even within our own campuses, how are we speaking and does everyone understand what's being said? There were several, there are five areas that we wanted to focus on. The last one, as it relates to institutions, is data evaluation and quality improvement. I talked about the importance of collecting data. We don't have to have these really robust systems, although it's always helpful if you do. I love data. But the more important thing, I think, is how you use the information. How are you reviewing your programs? Is everyone across the campus that needs the information receiving that information? I think that as we get into Sandy's presentation, we're going to look at some of the things that they've done at the University of the Incarnate Word to actually put a lot of these things that the research has told us is important, how they've actualized them. And so, Sandy?
Great. Before we go to that, though, I want to ask one more question related to what Elizabeth just talked about, and it was data. Because as we know, assessment is very important, especially from financial aid. I know that y'all know that. So, but data on campuses is collected differently, and you may be getting it from different sources. So I'm just curious if anyone would like to share institutional data on your campus. If you had to, right now, pick up the phone and call someone on your campus and get some institutional data, who would you call? Okay, institutional research, IR. Do you have direct contact with those, with that? And how do they communicate with you on a regular basis?
Go ahead.
Okay. Institutional research was their answer, which.
They are doing a lot of drilling down to what our student population looks like. And we're a private institution and we're small, but like a lot of private schools, you can't do what you've always been doing. And right. So they're helping us to look at trend data. Okay. And this is all new, but we're having big conversations this year, which is really exciting because it is putting the student first.
Absolutely.
And it, you know, we have a new president started August 1. We have a new VP of Enrollment Management October 3rd. So there are a lot of things that
That's how she knew those dates just right off the top of her head. I'm impressed.
But it's all been very positive. And for once, I feel like we're putting the student first. So that's really exciting.
So as far as disseminating the information, is there a systematic dissemination of it?
Yeah, it comes to our VP who then forwards it out to. I'm an assistant director in financial aid, and so I get that information.
Okay. How do you get it?
Through email and the reports, and I understand how to read that. I'm a PhD student, so okay. I'm interpreting that okay. I don't know if everyone does, but nice. But
excellent.
Yeah.
All right. Anybody want to talk about their systematic way of receiving institutional data, or if you have a systematic way of receiving institutional data? Okay. Great. Let's talk about my school then, because I love to tell our story, right? I'm from the University of the Incarnate Word in San Antonio, as we talked about. And we were founded in 1881 by the Sisters of Charity of Incarnate Word. We're a Hispanic-serving institution, and we've had the same president for 25 years. And he has one mantra, and it is, we are going to grow and serve South Texas. And we have been very true to that mission. Our Sisters of Charity are very dedicated to service. And we feel that our campus is meant to serve San Antonio and South Texas. And the question about how to increase retention, that's not an answer that on our campus we even want to look at. We're very proud of our growth. And you can see that in mid-1990s, we had just over 2,800.
We now have 8,455 students enrolled, and those are on campuses in China, Mexico, throughout San Antonio. We have adult completion programs, and we have online programs. And we're very proud of our growth. And again, the reason why we're proud of our growth is not just because we're growing, but because we are keeping the profile that we want to keep. We have 53% Hispanic students, 12% of other minorities, 22% of white, 8% unknown. Again, and we're trying to help them know, but that's part of IR's role. And then 4% of non-resident aliens, right? And then just as importantly, and what this graph may be a little bit difficult for you to see, but I wanted to include it because at this point I wanted to tell you where I got the data, more importantly than just the data. As you can see with our first generation students, that since 05, we've had a 58% growth in first generation students. And that's been very intentional because again, what we're looking for is we want to continue our mission of access for students, right? Yeah.
Are you defining that as self-reported first generation?
Self-reported, and then we self-report in two different directions. Is number one on the admission application, and then also through the FAFSA. So we're looking at it from two different directions, and we combine those. And she does a lot of cross relationships with those. But what I really wanted to show with you on this graph is where I obtained the data. Is we realized that a lot of things that we were doing, and we're getting ready to tell you our story of what we were doing, is a lot of things that we were doing is we were looking at increasing persistence to graduation, is we were doing them in silos, is everyone was deciding, oh, this is a wonderful thing to do. And like the answers that all of you gave, all of those are wonderful initiatives, and all of us would come up with this great idea. As a faculty member, I would decide, oh, I'm going to do this. When I became the director of first-year engagement, oh, I'm going to start this peer mentor program. Oh, my goodness, I'm going to put this in orientation. Oh, my. And when I finally learned about financial aid, and those of you that are in financial aid, your language, I will tell you, is very hard to learn. I have an MBA, and it took me a long time to learn it. But the point is, we were doing a lot of things in silos, so we finally got the thought, how important is IR, right? Very, very important. So we did a very intensive search for the right person to be sitting in our IR. We had faculty members, key administrators from all of our campus on the search. And our IR person has actually created a share drive where she puts the data that we all have access to it on a regular basis, and we can access it through the internet. So it's not just, and again, our past way of doing it was through emails that were key people that would get it. We're trying to disseminate it to our staff members and our faculty members, but it kind of got to a class system, is if you knew the right person, you received the data on a more regular basis, and it was always if you knew the right person to pick up the phone call. So these types of graphs that you're looking at are available, and we can access them 24/7. They're internet-based, and we want everybody on our campus to have them. So and this is just an example of a graph that she shares with us, and so I wanted to show that with you, right? On our campus, right, being a Hispanic-serving institution in South Texas, of course we have student challenges that many of you may have. Lack of adequate preparation for post-secondary education, lack of role models for post-secondary education, financial problems compounding academic problems, problems engaging in the culture of learning. So, and we came up with that definition by bringing everybody to the table together because it was real easy to say, okay, students aren't prepared for education. And faculty said what? What do you think faculty's first reaction was? Okay. Absolutely. It wasn't not our problem. It was they're just not learning it in high school, right? Who's going to take care of it? And on our campus, it really wasn't our problem. And maybe I just think that because I came from faculty. But it was more of, you know what? This is happening before they get there, right? Should we do something about it before they get there? And we realized again, no, we're not going to be able to do that. So as a campus, we have to come together and we're going to have to figure a way to make this happen on our campus.
How many of you have a proactive way of engaging students on your campus and looking at this whole culture of learning?
I believe we do.
You believe that you do at SMU?
Yeah. And also, if you could tell us what engagement means to you on your campus.
Okay.
All right. Our admissions department has a program called Mustang Days, where we bring in junior and senior high school students who are prospective students interested in coming to our campus. So on that day that they come in, they get to meet with, of course, admissions. And they also have an opportunity to meet with student financials, and they tour the campus. And so they talk to them about several different options and, you know, courses and curriculum that they're interested in. So I believe that that's one way that we engage. So we invite, you know, these juniors and seniors onto our campus, first of all. Secondly, you know, as a campus, we also try to, you know, keep our students informed, you know, of everything, of our resources available to them, whether that be via email, through, we have televisions that we air messages on for them to know what's going on and how we're able to assist them in all shape, forms, and fashion. And then there's another program on our campus where they actually take DISD students. This is in Dallas. Okay. And these students are first-year generation. It's called Trio Programs. You may be familiar. Mm-hmm. You've heard of that. So I think that that's nice. That's a good program. Unfortunately, it's basically STEM to first-year generation students or low income. But then you have some students that may not be low income, you know, that still need the assistance of you know, trans, right, you know, transferring from the secondary school to higher ed. So as you were speaking, I was thinking along those lines, right, what can we do?
Absolutely. Okay. One of the challenges that we saw on our campus was when we started talking about student engagement. And I should back up and tell you what really started this conversation was what someone alluded to earlier, was accreditation, right? When we were looking at our self-accreditation, is we said, what do we really want on our campus? And we want student success. And the easiest way to define student success is through retention and persistence. But we looked back and we said, if we just talk about retention and persistence, you're looking at it at the outcome level rather than at the income level. So we wanted to start talking about student engagement, but we realized when we talked about student engagement, everybody on campus had a different idea of what that meant. And to some people, it just meant what was going on in the classroom. It just meant to other people that they were involved in co-curricular activities. So what we did as a campus was we sat down and we actually put it in writing. We said, at the University of the Incarnate Word, students are engaged in the learning when. And if you'll notice that all the statements, and I'm not going to read to you because you can read, it's all student-centered. And in a moment, we're going to see why this was an effective mode, but not quite the most effective mode. Because we knew the first step, again, was defining it, making sure that we all use the same definition and using very student-centered terms. And if you noticed on the very last bullet statement, that they get involved with a variety of campus programs and services. And we realized quickly, we're a commuter campus. We have about 66% commuter students. So to get your commuter students engaged on campus, we realized that although we want them engaged in all of these varieties of things, where are they going to be most of the time when they're on campus?
In class.
So we needed to get to the classroom, and we needed to help the faculty understand how they were the best spokespersons for helping us understand how to get students engaged both inside and outside of the classroom. So in 2004, we were able to obtain a Title V collaborative grant, and most of the stories on our campus of most of our successful initiatives are tied to some grants in some forms, and I only include a few of them here, and we're very thankful for being able to secure grants. And in 2004, we received a Title V collaborative grant, and that grant was specifically centered on increasing student engagement. And we knew that for that to happen, we needed to get everybody on board. And that's when I assumed the role of the director of first year engagement and actually worked with the Title V grant. And then various initiatives that we had, and again, without going through the various initiatives, what I wanted you to realize is that you have to be very systematic on your campus, and that's what we have been, is we actually developed a timeline of these are the things that we're going to do. Some of the keynotes that you see on there are some task forces that we're going to talk about in a moment. And the reason why those are important is because, again, this story is not about this is what one office did, this is what this office did. It's about collaborating on the campus, bringing everybody together. So we, back 1 second. All right, thank you. All right, so what we did was, this was not a timeline that things just evolved, is we put out the structure, and then in 2008, we actually restructured to meet our student enrollment needs, right? And our restructure was taking our, actually taking student success and creating a department, and I am the, I'm now currently the dean of that department, but we're gonna talk about how we tied that department to all of the departments on campus. We started again with our faculty. We know our faculty are key, and the reason why they're key is two reasons. Number one, they spend the most time with your students. But when a student is selecting a college and they're looking at a school that they want to attend, what they care about is actually what's going on in the classroom. As administrators, we like to think all of the other things are just as important. We like to think our student programming, our financial aid office, I like to think my first year engagement office, that those are really key and important, and they are. But to your student, what they really are thinking about is the classroom, because they're coming from an environment where that's what they do, is they do classroom learning. So we needed to get to our faculty. So we did, first of all, what we did was we used our Blackboard sites, and that's our learning management system, and some of you may have different ones, for full-time and adjunct faculty. And we enrolled all of our faculty in those sites. And again, having the provost involved in it, at the faculty development workshops, she encouraged all faculty to check in on that. She told them she was monitoring it, that she was actually the instructor of record along with myself on it. What we put in those Blackboard sites were things that many of you may be taking for granted, is things like financial aid, why is it important? SAP, up until 5 years ago, I couldn't even have told you what that meant. Nor did most of our faculty. So we actually put it on the Blackboard sites, and we were using language that the faculty could understand. As the faculty understand, you tell your students to log on to these sites, we need you to log on to these sites too. So we were taking the style of learning of what they were using, we took their toolkit, and we took it and said, okay, we're gonna use the same toolkit that you use with the students with you. We also established an advisory board for faculty development. And again, as you know, one of the things that most faculty don't like to hear is we're going to teach you, right? Right? And I think that's true for most adults, right? Is we like to learn, but we don't like to necessarily say we're going to be taught. So it was important to have the advisory board for faculty development, and we selected a very key senior faculty member to actually chair the board and to actually oversee the initiatives. And then we created workshops on collaborative learning, because again, as we were looking back, we were looking at the model, right? If we wanted our students to be engaged, right, it's just like y'all in this classroom, or in this room, is you're only engaged if you're participating. Right now, me talking to you is not collaborative learning, but when you're sharing your story, you're actually involved in the learning process. And we all know that intuitively, but it doesn't always happen. So what we did was we took key faculty members and had them model it for other faculty members.
How willing were your faculty members participating in this?
Extremely.
Willing was her faculty members in participating in this?
Very willing, but again, the key was having our provost involved in it. And yeah, in just a moment, we're gonna talk about, we cohorted our faculty. Just like we cohort our students, we cohorted our faculty, and I'm gonna tell you that initiative in a moment. But again, I cannot stress to you how key it is to have the right people on board on this. Our chief academic officer, our provost, we have our vice president of enrollment services on our committees. And what we do on the faculty services is we have the provost send out the invitations, and she always attends also. She can't always stay for the whole thing. She's very busy, obviously, but she always attends. She always opens the meetings. She actually drives the conversation on it. Very important. Did you have a comment also? Please.
Question for other institutions. Absolutely. And, you know, I know your faculty, and I agree they're not a difficult faculty to work with at all.
They're not. They're great. Thank you.
But for the other institutions, what are ways that they use, what, you know, strategies do they use to engage the faculty in something like that? Because, yeah, they will not want to be taught. So
that was our question for our next page, so I like it when people have this. So excellent. Y'all want to go ahead and share that? Anyone?
Do you guys know of any programs that you might have on your campuses that is targeted at, in, I guess, developing faculty so that they'd be more engaging with their students?
I think they
right there?
Senate.
Start over, please.
on our campus, it's the Faculty Senate who is the driving force in getting other faculty members to be involved in student engagement.
Excellent. Thank you.
And we find, I mean, the research tells us without question, if you have one element or factor to look at as it relates to retention and completion, faculty are the most important in students persisting through graduation. Absolutely.
Absolutely. On a previous slide, we looked at our definition of student engagement. And we thought, again, as on the task force that we had that worked on that, we thought it was very effective. We made handouts, we gave it to students, we gave it to faculty, we gave it to parents, and then we did a self-assessment, and we asked them about 3 months later, can you please define in student engagement? And most of them came in with students involved in their learning. That's what we got from most people. And we said, well, can you give any specifics? And they couldn't. And again, what we realized was we gave them too much, right? So we developed this visual on active learning, which is exactly the bullet points that you saw when students are engaged in learning. And it's just a very simple picture. But the nice part about this was the people that actually responded to this most were our parents. As we actually distribute this at all of our orientations, and the parents actually can understand this. And as we go around the green circles that are on the outside, as we remind them to help us remind their students. Because again, remember, many of our students are first generation. Many of our students, we also have many Hispanic students on campus. And Hispanic culture is a fantastic culture. And it's very family centered, which is a positive, because you want to partner with your families to reach your students. But then there is also a side of it that we need to help educate the parents that, although yes, we agree completely, family is the most important, right now school needs to be the most important for your student. And we need to help you need to help us help them understand that. So again, if you go back at your campus and you look at some of your definitions that you have and some of the language you have, the lesson here is if you can put it in a visual, they're more likely to understand it. And what we did was we laminated this. We asked parents to put it on their refrigerators. We send it to all the students. And many times parents will come to me and they'll ask me, they'll say, well, do you know if my son or daughter has bought their textbooks? Right? And again, it's because we've helped them understand that. And that's a very small thing. But we know that helping the parents understand that that's important. And from financial aid, you know that too, that sometimes the students just might not have the money to be able to do that. So Elizabeth?
Okay. How many of you, I want to get a sense, if you had to go back to your campus today and begin a process of, establishing active learning on your campus, what would be a first step that you would take? How would you begin this process? We want you to actually be able to leave here and go do something with what we're talking about.
We're going to tell you my story in a minute, but we want to hear y'all's.
One of the things I had looked at, I made a note to myself, was we have a retention committee that's primarily made up of student members from different student services offices. Right. And it has two branches. One is, what do they call it? Civic and social engagement, kind of that personal investment of time and commitment to being a part of the campus, and the other is the academic arm of the retention committee. So part of that, I was thinking, we have this hub of student services, but there's not a faculty representative on that committee.
On our retention and enrollment committee, we have a faculty member from each of our schools and colleges.
And I think that's really, that's just like hitting me right now, and we mention it going, wow, faculty, that'd be swell, but we don't, it's like there seems to be this wall, and of course between student services and faculty, and I hear lots of nods, yes, it's not us. But it really is that, getting involvement, because of course it's faculty. That's why they're going to college. They're going to sit in a room and learn stuff, and it just kind of hit me like a ton of bricks. I can't believe we haven't really worked that angle a little bit more. But we have people in a committee and people who are already committed to it. It's just a matter of really taking the initiative and sticking our necks out and saying, no, we need academic side to be involved in this as well.
Fabulous.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And that buy-in from the top is huge. So thank you for that.
Absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. The way that we started the process on our campus was we divided the first year experience into three areas:
orientation, first-year curriculum, and advising. And in a moment, you're going to hear the story of why we do not have a first-year experience class. So many of you that have that class, it's a wonderful class, and we're going to talk about why we don't in a moment. But the key, again, to each of these was not, it wasn't any magic to it, but the key was that we had faculty and administrators on each of the committees. And the whole idea was to look at, if these are high impact for our students, what can we all do to revamp them to make them work? The task force directives, and again, they came down from our provost, and they were communicated through the faculty senate to the task forces. And the nice thing about it, again, was were these committees, since they were formed by the provost, the faculty could also use them in their rank and tenure process. So that's always very important when you're working with your provost that the faculty understand that. Was to analyze our current programs, develop recommended assessments, and recommend any changes or revisions to each of these areas. And the other thing that the provost did that I thought was very clever is they had someone chair the committee that had absolutely no knowledge of that area. So for instance, I chaired orientation. At that point, when we first started this, I had no idea what orientation was about. We now have orientation in my division due to it, but that's okay too. Okay. QEP task force updates. Collaborations on the planning process. We made things mandatory for first-year students. And most important on this bullet, and again, if you're not doing this, is parent programming during your orientation. And we had it, but it was a second thought. We realized that through this process, parent programming is just as important now as our student programming, and we require students to attend, we strongly encourage parents to attend, and those that don't, we send the information out to them. First-year curriculum goals, and again, this is the area that I think that we're the most proud of on campus, is what we did was we looked back and we said, okay, faculty, and this committee was made up completely of faculty, and I was also on the committee, and at that point I was no longer faculty. I was actually an administrator at that point, but I was the only administrator on the committee. Everyone else was faculty, and it was chaired by two senior faculty members, and we brought in a lot of research about student success and completion rate, because you know faculty by nature are researchers. So if you can bring them the data, and that I think is the most important way to start to get your faculty involved, is you just show them the data. And once they realize that the data says, you know what, this is the reason why students aren't being successful, and your key to success, what can we do about it? Okay.
Just before we move on, how many of you have first year experience courses on your campus?
Student development.
Okay.
Excellent.
Well, I guess one more question. How many of you actually have a goal for the first year of your student on your campus? Because that struck me when I saw her first year curriculum goals, the fact that they had them. How many of you have them? That might be an interesting discussion. Yeah. If we can get a microphone over here, please.
Nice. Those goals are set by a freshman program, first year program. Mm-hmm. Called University College, mm-hmm. and they focus in on setting goals and objectives for all first-year students.
Very nice. Good. I think that a number of times we look at what the students don't know, you know, about what to expect when they get on campus, the college experience, but many of us don't have any expectation, you know, by the time that you leave here, X, Y, and Z will have been accomplished. These are the goals that we, you know, expect you to accomplish in your first year. I think that we need to be much more intentional as we engage our students, and so something to discuss when you get back to your campuses.
Sandy, I had a question.
Sure.
Under the first-year curriculum goals.
Absolutely.
Can you give us some examples of how students interact with faculty members outside of the classroom?
Okay.
What are some of the activities or?
Absolutely. In fact, I can tell you about one that's just wonderful. And what makes this one such a wonderful success story was it was actually developed because of this. And I want to go back to these goals. Is the faculty committee on first-year curriculum actually wrote the goals themselves? So we didn't give these to them. This didn't come from student success. This didn't come from student support. This came from the faculty, as they said, this is what we should define. We had done a lot of work with BEAMS, with some other organizations to give them some guidelines, but they decided that these were in there. So becoming involved with faculty outside of the classroom is we asked the faculty, Can you design some projects in your course outlines that actually assist the students in doing that? And one faculty member stepped up and said, I can do more than that. I'm going to develop a university-wide project, and it's called Meet the Mission. Because, again, we're a very mission-driven university, and our mission is based on service. And if you haven't visited our website, it's www.uiw.edu. And it has a wonderful...
She does not have a marketing background,
that's right. though. And I don't love my university at all, can you tell? Thank you very much. So anyway, it's very mission driven. So Meet the Mission. It's actually, it's a cohort of first year faculty, and a faculty member developed it. We've designated a day. It's within the first 2 weeks of school. We tried to do it originally before school started, but now it's within the first 2 weeks of the first semester of school. And faculty sign up for it, and they get to pick an agency that they're committed to. And we take the, and the students actually come together. They go to the service or agency with the faculty member and complete a day of service. Now, we've expanded that now beyond the first year. Now we have a second year Meet the Mission Day where the students can go back to the same agency. And what's really been neat to, as we've done that is the students have self-reported that I think it was, and I don't really want to state this number, so since we're being recorded, I want to tell you this one's from memory. It's not an actual IR number. I think it was about 33% of the students reported that they had actually been actively engaged with that particular agency, and if not, with one related to it. And what we asked the faculty to do was, first of all, pick something that meant something to you so you could tell the story. And then when we came back, we brought all the students together, and we asked them to reflect not just on the service activity, but how does this help you develop as a professional? So students were starting to now understand that it's not just what you're learning in the classroom, but you can take other experience that you have that you're learning also. And then another way that we've done it also, and again, the key to this was, and when we get to the target course slide in just a moment, is the faculty were asked to redesign their course outlines. And it was remarkable how many did that. And I'm going to tell you why in just a moment that we think that that was successful. Okay? All right, our target core courses. Before I tell you the success of this, I want to tell you we actually got to this because we did something that you may have done on your campus, is we wrote a grant that looked like something wonderful to do, and that was expand our first year experience class. We had it on a very small scale. It was a student self-selected if they wanted to take it. It was tested in various disciplines, but we wrote a grant and said, okay, we're gonna make this a university-wide requirement. Okay, sounds good, right? But who owns curriculum? The faculty, right? So we received the grant. We went to Faculty Senate, and they said, not such a good idea. They said, we already have too many general ed classes. We don't really like that idea. And it's like, well, you know what? We're committed to this. We have the funding. So let's figure out a way that we can do it. So again, remember, we had a committee on the first-year curriculum. All right. So could you go back to my target core slide for a second?
Okay.
So, and this was really neat. This graphic that you're looking at was actually developed by a faculty member that was the chair of the theater department at the time, is because everybody in the classroom was talking, and they said, well, I mean, everybody in the committee was talking, and they were saying, well, saying that's a really neat idea, but if you just pull the students out, and you just have one faculty member or even an administrator teaching the students those skills, are they really going to learn it? Now, this was so rich to hear faculty say it. They said, we all need to be teaching them those things. So how can we do that? So we identified the classes that the majority of our first-year students take, and we call those our target core courses. And it starts in the center because those are the students that if they need any of what we call the bridge classes, which are your developmental classes. And then we have a class called Dimensions of Wellness, which is a class that all of our students take. And then everyone else takes a religion class on our campus, and of course English, a math class, and a philosophy class. So what we did was we took those courses, we asked all the faculty members that were teaching those courses to look at the first year curriculum goals and how many of those could you intentionally integrate into your course outline. And the way that you intentionally integrate them is you put it in writing,
because it wasn't enough that they just said, okay, we're going to do it. And across the board, in each one of those disciplines, every chair came back with a revised course outline that actually integrated those, and we were able to have 100% of the curriculum outcomes integrated into at least one of those courses. Okay? And then the next step was getting the students into those classes. So we implemented a process where we pre-schedule all of our first-year students, and it's a wonderful opportunity. Okay? Great. So the next step was, all right, we've got this wonderful piece of paper. We've got these great things. How do we get it to all of our faculty? And I don't know on your campus, but on our campus, we have a lot of adjunct faculty also. Right? So we needed to find a way to consistently get this message to our faculty. So we created faculty cohorts. And so many times on our campus, we have student cohorts. Right? We have our first-year students. You might have your first-generation students. We have our Hispanic student organizations. But we had never actually taken our faculty together other than related to research and placed them together. So the first step was we took all of our faculty that taught our first-year students, and the provost invited them together to come together and say, how committed are you to this initiative? And if you're committed, we invite you to join this cohort. We had 45 faculty members when we started, and we were very proud to say we still have 45 active. Not necessarily the same 45, just because we've had some of them assign different faculty meetings, obligations. What we do with the faculty cohort is we meet on a regular basis, again with the provost, and we listen to the faculty. We let them come together, and we select key faculty members at each meeting. At first, we started meeting once a month. We're down now to twice a semester just because we feel like we've done a lot of rich work with the first faculty. And they share best practices in the classroom is how are you actively reaching your students? We expanded that then to faculty that are teaching our second-year students, and we call that faculty our focus faculty. Because we want, at the second year, we want the students to start to focus on their major and focus on how they're moving forward. So again, the idea of cohorting faculty seemed very simple to us when we did it. We didn't realize how innovative it was going to be and how very successful it really is. So do any of y'all do any of that type of work on your campus with your faculties? Okay. Keep going. What was very important, and again, realized that we had three QEP task forces, and the reason why I concentrated on the faculty development was because I think most of you in the room were more familiar with the orientation and the advising components, so I wanted to move to the area that I thought might be a new area for you. But what was very important is as we were tracking progress is that we had internal measures and we had external measures, and we effectively communicated that to all of the stakeholders, because we realized if we wanted faculty, and again, I'm concentrated on faculty here, but we also had administrators from all offices on campus, is that we had to have internal measures and external measures and communicate them consistently to your stakeholders. So for instance, on our target core courses, at the end of each semester, we actually sent out to each of the disciplines the persistence and retention and student success rates that their particular discipline showed for that semester. And it was really interesting to listen to them have the dialogue of what can we do to change this? What is happening? And the first response, if they had negative numbers, what do you think their first response was? What would your response be if you were in the classroom and you had negative? What do you think the first response was? Anybody want to share? Okay. It was, oh, they weren't ready to be in college, right? And it was interesting to watch the evolution, because the first time, and again, what the purpose of the cohorting was, these are colleagues we're very comfortable with sharing with each other, and those types of comments are okay. And what they said after they said it is, so what can we continue to do to help them since they're not ready to be in college? And the first time that got said in the first faculty cohort, the provost and I looked at each other and went, ah, it works. It really worked. Okay? Right? So some other continued initiatives, and again, realizing that you can attack it at the classroom level, But the bottom line is the students also have to have the responsibility. So while we were integrating with the faculty, we also had a lot of student initiatives going on, academic coaches for our students. We have peer mentors for our students. We looked at our tutoring models. And again, when we looked at our tutoring models is we brought faculty, students, and administrators together to say what type of tutoring models work for you. And I could talk to you all day about our tutoring models, but the only one I'm going to mention is our past tutoring model. Is what we did was we identified our high-risk classes and we implemented a modified supplemental instruction because supplemental instruction won't work on our campus for many reasons, and mostly it's time constraints of our students. It's also faculty workload, classroom. What modified supplemental instruction is that you have a student that actually holds tutoring sessions at the same time that the faculty member has office hours. So the students are able to come to the tutoring session. It's optional, but highly encouraged. And the faculty member's office hours are at the same time, so the faculty can actually be pulled in for the conversation. And what the reason why this model works, again, was because the faculty were very supportive of it. So they will do things on their quizzes and their tests and ask questions about things that actually happened in the supplemental instruction or the past sections. So even though they're not required, students find out very quickly, aha, when I go there, I get a little bit of insight. Some other initiatives that we brought on our campus are summer programming that we know is very important for your students. Begin UIW, when we talked about the transition to college, is if you know your students are not quite prepared for college, then why would you put them in the classroom the first day of school? So we've been looking at, we developed summer programs that actually help the students with some of their bridge classes. We've also developed funding, and again, very important that you have your university behind it so that the students can afford your programs. Okay. And then again.
Do we have a question?
Oh, sure.
Okay. Could you expand on first-year faculty as a question?
All right, first-year faculty is actually faculty that teach first-year students.
Okay.
Thing.
And it's with the courses that you were talking about before that class?
Actually, they can teach any first-year class. She just asked me about first-year faculty. And first-year faculty are faculty that teach first-year students. The majority of them do teach the target core courses, but they can teach any first-year class. And one of the things that was interesting is when we first started calling them first-year faculty, we realized that wasn't too good because they thought we meant faculty their first year at the university. So then we started calling them first faculty, and then people understood it. And then the really neat part about it was our provost actually created plaques that said first faculty. And we put them on the faculty's doors, and we tell the students, this way you know that this faculty has actually been trained to work with first-year students, so if you have questions, go in and ask them, and they're very proud of those. And with the focus faculty, we did the same thing as we developed some visuals that the students and the faculty could recognize.
I just wanted to interject that some of you might be sitting here thinking, wow, well, that's great. You're Dean of Student Success. You have that ability. But even in your positions where you are, there are things that you could do that could begin to change the culture on your campus and even persuade faculty to begin behaving differently. If there's some certain recognition that you can give them, like Friends of Financial Aid or something that is acknowledging that these faculty members are going above and beyond, and as a result, they're helping contribute to our completion agenda, you can do that from where you sit. You don't have to be buddies with the president and working with all the leaders of these departments, but from where you are, you can come up with those suggestions to really move your campus forward.
So most of the initiatives that we talked about originally were dealing with our first-year students. And we realized that, okay, so we're in a moment you're going to see the progress that we made. Because, again, remember we started these initiatives in 2004 and 2005. So we definitely saw some strong movements with our first year, but we realized that we needed to work on our persistence. And on our campus, and Elizabeth actually shared with me that I understand that other campuses have different definitions, our campus retention is first to second year, and persistence is beyond that. So it's actually persistence to graduation. So what we have now established is called a Directions and Connections Center. And the Directions and Connections Center's main only responsibility is to effectively communicate to all of the other offices and to the students, the faculty advisors, all of the key elements as we're persisting to graduation. And it's done, and it's just in the process of being developed. It's utilizing technology appropriately for outreach. And you notice that down on the bottom left-hand corner is financial aid, and we know that that's very critical. And as Elizabeth was saying, because I know many of you are financial aid officers, is our financial aid officer on our campus has a very strong voice. She sits on many of our committees, and has done an excellent job of helping the faculty and other administrators understand the key role that financial literacy does play. So that's definitely one of the elements that has been integrated into the curriculum. Okay. So this is our story of success. In fall of 2004, we had a 63% retention rate, and we're now proud to have a 78% retention rate in just 5 years. So that's excellent. And again, remember, we did that without tweaking the incoming profile of our students at all. In fact, in some ways, it actually shifted to a little bit more student that needed a little bit more college readiness because we felt like we were prepared to do that. Okay? And our persistence rate has also increased by about 12 to 13% in a 2-year period as we started focusing on that area. So again, our story is not, it's not a unique story. It's just the way that we took our campus. And the key to success on your campus for students is collaboration on your campus. And I hope that as you go back on your campus, you look and you think, are there languages that we're using that may not be consistent in our departments? So before we close, we wanted to see that if anyone had any questions for us.
And just a compliment to Sandy, and the reason why I often will seek her out, because I work with campuses across the country, I attend a lot of conferences, and everyone talks about limiting access or increasing selectivity to improve retention and graduation. And in looking at the growth that UIW experienced, you don't grow that way while you're becoming more selective. They have one of the most challenged student populations imaginable, and looking at the fact that they're low resource, very low socioeconomic status, and then also from their academic preparation and their backgrounds, they are some of the students that we fear the most that will lose the quickest. And they're doing such an amazing job. And so this is a demonstration to me that every one of us can be successful on our campuses. What questions?
I did want to add that the three task forces that we have are no longer sitting task forces, but we have formed an enrollment and retention committee. And as I stated earlier, our enrollment and retention committee is co-chaired. I chair it with the dean of enrollment, who is admissions. And we have a faculty member from each of our schools. And we also have the financial aid office, the business office, and a representative from the registrar's office on the committee and campus life. So that we meet once a month to talk about challenges for students, but more importantly, to talk about programs that can assist the students. So thank you for coming.
We wanted to just tell you that you have evaluations again that Melissa's holding up, showing me that she needs you to complete and to give to her. I want to focus your attention on the last slide, and that's looking at barriers to success. We don't have time to really go into this. What we were going to do was have you identify the barriers that are on your campus. And so we want you to very intentionally make your list. What are the barriers that you can identify to success on your campus? And then how can you be instrumental in moving your campus beyond those barriers? Whether you are an assistant director, just a counselor, director, all of us have the ability to help move the needle forward regardless of where you sit. That's what we want to leave you with today. And so hopefully we'll hear your success stories, and I'll have one of you up presenting with me talking about what you guys did on your campus, yeah, too.
And I'll add that as you're having these conversations on barriers to success, is one of the things that you have to agree to when you come into the room to do this is to not be afraid to admit them. You know, every one of those barriers to success we had on our campus, right? And some of them we still have, right? But we're not afraid to talk about it. And when we come in the room together, is sometimes we agree to disagree. And that's very important. So good luck and have fun.